With Barbara Billingsley as the bee, no, the rat, the ferret, the, what is, I'm not quite sure what that is, but somebody's going to be.
Irving Zimmern is a man without a time. A time without a place. A place without a man. A man without a watch. Irving Zimmern lives in a two-dimensional flat world, and he has absolutely nothing to do with this video. Come with me now to a place that had its time. A place that had its watch. A watch that belongs to our first guest, among others who are real people in the Highlight Zone.
Missed the Flintstones.
Well, to answer your question, no. I don't think drugs really affected me at all that much. I mean, you figure, back when I started writing some early tunes, I was a pretty heavy user. I figured back then, all I needed was like Tasty Waves, Cool Buzz, and I was fine. But now you figure, I got out of it. I'm a scientific supply rep, got a good job, steady home. I figure, look at me! This kid can make it. Anybody can.
So, Rob, what do you sell?
Pharmaceuticals. What?
The old place hasn't changed much in 2 years.
Three flights of steps, that's a long way to take all those sample boxes. Hey, apartment H. Let's take a look inside. Well, I wish I could hop that rolling ramp. I see the layer of silver walking
high. I know there's a breeze out there, but they hide it.
Oh my God.
Oh my God.
A rodent in an apartment.
He's staring you down, too. What's a typical day for a USA salesman in Raleigh like? Well, if it's like today, it's not very typical, because today's Sunday and we're just pretending. But if today were Monday, even the apartment might look something like this. Don't be alarmed. We clean this place once a day. Yep, two aspiring young businessmen who live with two small ferrets. It's the ferrets that keep the apartment looking so clean.
Oops, oops.
Hey, the Home Entertainment Center. Is that where the camera is now? Terrific. You can see the CD player, the Dolby stereo decoder, the VCR, the cable box with every cable station known to mankind. It's got a small tape deck somewhere up there, and a tuner, and a widescreen TV, and don't forget the two Klipsch speakers right up front. I'm psyched.
Then we get to the business end of the apartment.
Ring, 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 ring. What? Someone's got to get the phone. Ring, ring.
Don't bother trying to find Rob yet. We'll get him in a minute. Gotta go.
Well, welcome to another room of a USA Scientific apartment. This is the this is the kitchen. I'm psyched about the kitchen. I spend a lot of time here, as does my roomie Ed. That was Ed you just saw a second ago. And look, it's immaculate, as it is every day. My wonderful roommate Ed has done the dishes, I see. What a guy. This place has never looked better. I'm psyched.
Roll them. One 1:31 in the morning. A typical day for Rob.
Desperado, why don't you come to your senses? You've been out riding.
Let's go catch Rob in the bathroom.
So long, well, hold your heart on. I know that you have reasons. Things that are pleasing you.
Put it away. The price of fetal pro-bite syrup has gone to $105. I can't believe it. Sorry, look, I got a good morning. A problem? You got a problem at what? UNC. Okay, yeah, I'm writing this down. Hold on, one second. Okay, I'll tell you what, I'll take care of that today. I will take care of that today. Okay, I gotta go. Goodbye.
Just another typical work day at USA Scientific. Got my case, I got my book.
You forgot your shoes.
Got my car, don't worry about it. Gotta get organized before the day gets started. Can't leave this garbage. Okay, all right. I'm bye now. We'll be seeing you another fine day at USA Scientific.
Us, Bill. I don't know. Affected us all in such different ways. I think it just basically got us to understand ourselves better and about how to cope with other people. Dealing with life. You know, college was just a high point in my life, I think.
Literally?
More ways than one. It was, you know, had a good time with all my friends. Learned a lot about things that are utterly no importance in life, but they wanted you to learn these things to get grades for them, for who knows what reason. But, you know, we all did it, and you know, it's all behind us now, we're glad. We remember the fun times, and we hate the bad times. That's how it goes.
State University, located in the capital city of Raleigh. The school's enrollment currently stands at approximately 21,000 students, graduate and undergraduate levels combined. With 13 schools and programs of study, textiles, engineering, and agriculture being the most recognized, the institution offers a wide variety of academic programs for the excelling student. The million-plus volume library also supplies the students with vast amounts of information and a comfortable atmosphere in which to pursue their degree of study. This is what our parents send us to college for, but we know there's so much more.
Wasted the whole 1987, and I work with emotionally disturbed and mentally abused children. I never knew until just recently how much knowing the band was going to help me in my work.
Unlock the door of behavior, relieve my changing demons. Profess your constant diversion, thinking of where you won't go. Manage positive.
I can tell you exactly how I feel about rock and roll.
Would you mind?
All right, tell me.
My mind's racing with thousands of things to say.
Say them!
Phil?
Yeah.
Rock and roll.
Don't say it.
Started as... rock and roll started as an expression. Back in the 50s. A new form of communication, a new way to do things. And it not only was a new life, not only a new type of music, but a new type of culture. A whole way of thinking, a way of dressing, a behavior, a concepts, of beliefs. And then later on, in the 60s, it was even more intense because people began to truly admit their inner feelings and move and change the world with their ideas and their feelings centered around the basic concept and communal feeling associated with the liking of rock and roll, having the fact that they all enjoyed it and could communicate in that way, and those songs meant so much more back then. And then in the 70s,
disco.
People tried and it lost its communication, and now people put aside the communication of music to go into the communication with their own bodies and their own, and it detracted greatly from the music because the music now was nothing more than an avenue to supply them the means by which to express themselves using their bodies and their movements on the dance floor. And so music tended to suffer, and now it's having a great resurgence, and you're seeing great resurgence of classic rock and roll. And rock and roll is once again starting to rise because they are changing America with rock and roll, such as Band-Aid, such as the Christmas albums they're putting out now, and USA for Africa and We Are the World. People are once again trying to make a difference. John Cougar Mellencamp supporting
supporting their local music in schools and stuff like this. They're trying to make music once again and to have the meaning and be able to express the kind of feelings that it once had and have the positive influence it once had, which it no longer has. And that's why you're seeing great resurgence of classic rock and roll, because at that time bands wrote songs that meant a lot too, and meant a lot to everyone else. Today I think songs are written more on from a commercial standpoint, and in some, even the bands that don't write commercially, that write still center and focus. The bands that still are making and have stood around and that stood the test of time and changed, Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers, write about songs and write about things they see in their own life that they know other people can relate to. We're A minor. Now E's all right. Get you going, but A minor chord, boy. That's a sucker right there.
I just hope you're finished.
All right. Now look, tell me.
That's the shit that needs to go down the tape, man.
What else? What is that?
Like, fuck you, I know I'm in jail.
Rodney in jail.
Rodney in jail. Jailed in this immense body is a small mind with great expectations. Behind these fat little cheeks lies the heart of a true champion. A man you'd be proud to let your daughter date.
You are a fan driver. This is.
Hell yeah. Blow him up.
Rodney with DTs.
Okay.
Is it going?
Yeah.
Well, have you ever cussed out a cop? Have you ever shot a cop the bird? Have you ever been in a fire? Has your house ever been on fire? Have you ever been in a fire? I know a lot of firemen. One in particular, rather well. Bill, this is so stupid.
It's perfect. It's perfect.
They're, firemen are like disciples of Jesus. They go where they're needed, and they work wonders.
Is this on you? Or?
I never knew I was even a woman until I met a fireman. I never knew what a real fire hose was. I never knew the real meaning of hot.
They were on fire.
Now, let me tell you something. The next time you're on fire, you'll learn to appreciate a firefighter.
Get hosed down.
The real meaning of life. Bill and I have been discussing famine and old age, and I've discovered all my 26 years. The real meaning of life means living in the country, riding a mule, shoveling horseshit, feeding the chickens, running the canines, running the rabbit dogs.
Does music fit?
And there's a time and a place for everything, and eating a lot of turnip greens, and biscuits, molasses. This is the true meaning of life, living in the country, and in the words of the great John Denver, which I must include in this tape, he once said, blow up your TV, throw away the paper, move to the country, something about peaches, make a lot of babies, and try to find Jesus on your own.
the flames of the fire paint pictures on the ceiling. In watching them dance, I'm wondering how you're feeling. The stars in the sky are falling. Your name I keep calling. Darling, can you hear me? I love you. And it's another day without you. One I hope I can get through. And I'm thinking, sitting here, it sure be nice to have you near. I once had a dream, and in it it seemed we'd be together forever. But it's another day without you.
driving now, and as you see, we pulled up to the first place in our series of destination shots, which ought to be very interesting. And of course, a destination shot wouldn't be any good without your narrator. And this is the place where we began to practice, and I don't want to spend too much time here because I hated this place in the first place, so let's move on.
This is the first ever Destiny P.O. box. Oh my God, it's an exciting moment for us now.
I forgot which one it is. Oh, it's not important, just the box, Rob, just the box. This is the Wakefield bump. I wanted to get this because I hate this damn thing. It just doesn't. Here we are at Wakefield Mills Apartment, where four members were crazed, almost killed each other, lived together, created, had a band in an apartment. Really pretty bizarre sight. It was not a pretty thing. And to be quite honest with you, I don't know why we're here. It looks like they painted the place. I think the neighborhood has gone down since we've been here, though. This is where Rodney Fritz and his roommate, Wayne, tended to harass their neighbors. I don't think it's a pretty sight either, but let's get the hell out of here because I can't stay in this thing.
Is it
3143E? Is that it? 3259-7? What is it?
Something.
E.
And I wonder if the lady still lives here that Wayne and Rodney fuck with.
I believe. We also got all our shit dumped when we were here. We had about $15,000 worth of uninsured shit. And I tell you, that ain't no joke. And also, it can't be the broadest thing that we ever did. On our tour of tours, world tour, grand tour, what day is it? About time for us to be heading on out, but this is where the band has lived for the last year and a half. A couple drummers, no bass players. We're pretty much lost right now, but we're going to go ahead in and take a look inside, and we'll catch you later.
I've never known anyone to have the capacity to make a tape sound overproduced in a four-track studio.
We're trailblazers.
Yeah.
on the Russians.
Doing? I could never figure out exactly what it was that you guys were doing. Doug, looking kind of funny, buddy. Rodney, how's that space heater? Rodney? Doug? Hello? Thank you. I mean, like, all right, tell me, like, how does, like, other than up and down, how was your...
It's gone like this. Our relationship.
Okay.
Other than up and down, what?
All right, the question is, or maybe the question should be, what made you want to get married?
Doug is my best friend and my lover, all rolled into one. And I'm happy, very, very happy.
Why are you getting married?
Why am I getting married? Before I answer that question, I just want the camera to know that this cat has excruciatingly painful amounts of effluvians. In other words, this cat is farting on me in a really major way. And, like, your ass really stinks, dude. See, even she'll agree. The question why I'm getting married, well, it's a multifaceted answer. One which... if I don't watch what I say, it can get me into a lot of trouble here in front of Cindy. No, I'm in love. We're in love. As gushy and mushy as it sounds, it's true.
That doesn't make sense,
man. Okay.
Is the tape rolling?
Yes.
It is rolling. So it just caught me picking my nose.
Yeah.
So what would you rather know about? Alien sex or...
That sounds good.
Okay. Alien sex.
Alien sex.
Stand on...
This is obviously part of the reason why you're getting married.
Yeah, definitely. You stand on opposite ends of the room, and you watch each other take off your own clothes. And you've got some light music in the background, a couple of candles in there, of course.
Some incense, maybe, if you're like into the karma aspect of it.
So you're watching each other. You don't take your eyes out of each other, but at the same time, you're taking off your clothes completely while you're at opposite ends of the room. Then you walk towards each other really slowly until you meet in the middle of the room.
But you don't touch.
But you don't touch. And you get face to face with each other so that your skin is barely... So your skin is barely touching. And then you...
Okay, we'll demonstrate this.
You take turns and you outline each other's bodies.
Without touching.
And so that your facial, your skin hairs can feel
the closeness. And naturally you're in an aroused state, so your skin is like prickly
in
anticipation.
It's kind of like when you kiss somebody for the first time and you know you're going to kiss because your lips are really, really close, but you don't do it. And then you proceed to outline your body with your hands. You let your partner do it to you, and then you do it with your bodies. But this whole time you're never touching each other. And then you do it with your lips. And it's kind of, you know how exciting it can be to be really close to someone's lips, but not.
Usually, see, she's talking about getting within an inch or two of each other, but that's really not possible with me. It's usually more like 14 or 15 inches.
Do what you must do.
Just when you're starting to live, MS can strike.
What would Vern say about going out on a date on Saturday? He'd say, Bud, I want that puss. But I deserve it. Because I'm a good-looking guy. I'm a stud. I'm a nice guy. I drive a nice car. But I don't understand why I don't get that book, but...
More detail, please, Dean.
But first, she throws those legs up in the air like I like. I should be able to throw those legs anywhere I want, but behind her head, over her shoulder, over to the bathroom, in the shower, anywhere, bud. And then, she'd want to do it doggy style, but I wouldn't even have to ask her. First, she'd crawl over to the side of the bed like a champion. She would. And then, bud, she'd go ahead and stick that butt up in the air the way I like it. Always remember, Mud. Always remember. Stick that butt up in the air. Put those elbows down on the ground.
Alright, one more time. What would Vern say? What would Vern say? What Vern would say? Mm-hmm. Munch is, I'm being Munch being me.
That's right.
Yes.
I'm being Munch being me.
That's it.
About me going on a date.
That's it. Or going to a bar with Hack.
What are you doing tonight, Vern? Got this hot little day to sunny bud. Tight little bod, little butt up, built for speed and comfort. Tight little unit. Going out with her, had a few drinks, Applebee's. I don't know what else you gotta do, bud. Possible slam dancing. That's right, a little slam dancing, Queen. You don't know how to do slam dancing? So to save those diseases, always have those. Christmas coming. That's right. Merry Christmas. Say you love someone. Merry Christmas with the Christmas coming. I believe that's what Munch would say.
What does it take to continue a good relationship?
Sex.
Sex. Lots and lots of sex.
Lots of sex. Good, clean sex.
Sex and love. Or lust.
Sex and trust.
Sex and trust and lust and like. You can like somebody without loving them, and you can love somebody without liking them. Lots of sex.
Sex in, like, different places of the household. Around the house. Not just bed sex, but, you know, your average chair sex and sofa sex. But then
washer and dryer sex.
Yeah, washer and dryer sex.
Get that spin cycle.
Yeah. I didn't say okay. Relationships go. What's the next question?
You guys, we've been through so much and so many stories to tell, but one in particular stands in mind, and it has to do with hot brownies. The time I cooked them, you guys were practicing downstairs, and William, the unknowing non-smoker, non-eater, ate them and drove home and fussed with us in quarreling. What did he do? Sends us to the hospital. We're running all over the place. Urgent messages from Doug. All sorts of things. And then we all come together at Rob's, and we're wondering whether we should tell Stacy the truth or not. And they found some foreign substance of which we have no idea, Stacy. But really, we knew. And I guess when William showed up, we were all relieved. But in his own special way, he was telling us that we're just a bunch of fuck-ups. So let's do it again.
Parking lot. This is a real Bill Guandolo type thing right here. As far as Destiny goes, it's a strange situation. The band's got a lot of potential that for some reason never seems to get reached for some reason or another, one thing or another. Whether it's Bruce or whether it's band members or all kinds of wild shit going on. A lot of fun in the band, and I'm freezing my ass.
I don't know what it is. We're in a fucking parking lot again, and something about drummers and being a car salesman.
Are we on here?
We're on.
Hi, my name is Cy Abraham, and I'm a ex-drummer band called Death. I'm out here freezing to death because Bill Guandolo, my good old buddy from long, long ago, decided to come on out here and shoot this tape. See, I'm over here at the Suzuki lot at Altima Suzuki. I'm a business manager over here. Bill wanted me to tell you a funny, funny story about what used to happen over with the band. Well, I can't think of any. Well, really, the essence of what I want to say right here is what made Destiny the time we were all together. It was when you first started off, it was me and Bill and Rob. We used to call him Mr. Fix-It because everything he touched, he broke. Doug, which we used to call Gizmo or Spaz, and he had Rodney. What made us what we are, I guess, we're a bunch of geeks. We all got together and we just, our personalities complemented each other. A bunch of geeks that had a good time just playing rock and roll music, and I guess the reason I left is sooner or later I thought that some people out there would finally get a chance to listen to us, and that's when I knew that we'd have to end then. Other than that,
we're a bunch of orphans.
We're a bunch of orphans.
sure what to talk about. So I thought I'd talk about all the stupid, indecisive things we've done together as a group and individually. Unfortunately, we don't have tape for me to go into detail about that. So I'll just sum it up by saying we've done all the... But we've had fun! And we'll probably continue to do them in the future. Thank you.
Okay, all right. I'm going to tell you about all the brilliant things we've done. Because we're a brilliant group of people. Let's, for instance, let's take the time when we drove into a police lot to smoke a joint. Of course, then again, there was the time that we left about $15,000, $20,000 worth of equipment in an old barn in probably one of the worst sections of town to be ripped off. And of course, then there's the constant battling among our best friends to kill each other. And what I want to say is, ah, ah, I can't take it anymore! I can't take it! Ah! I'm okay now. You know, people keep asking me as we're doing this this video thing, is what it's all about. And I think, bottom line is, this whole thing's really about relationships and how as friends and in relationships, we should really learn to work together. Don't you think?
Yeah, I do. I think it's, you know, it's an everyday thing. It's not something that you can just take for granted and really have to work on.
I think that's true. I mean, I think anytime you have a relationship or a group of people in a relationship that you feel is real important, I think the whole message of this video is that you ought to try to savor that relationship. And it's really important. I mean, take, for example, us and...
We're going slow.
Huh?
We're slowly being cautious and making sure.
We're slowly making sure in our relationship. But part of the reason we do that is so we can truly understand each other. We don't want to have any misunderstandings. We want to really know how to work together. I mean, take, for example, you know, any situation that you may disagree in. Sex, drugs, rock and roll. And, you know, I mean, take, for example, animals. Like, if one person wants an animal and one person doesn't, I mean, that's a situation that you really need to work out. If one person should say, well, you know, here are the good reasons, and you know, these are things that we're going to talk about and work out so that, you know, we can understand each other in this situation. Right?
Yeah, for instance.
For example, with a dog, you know.
Well, a dog brings happiness into your life,
it's
a happy person,
quite
to be around, need to have a dog in the house.
Well, you know, you love the dog because they're so nice and cuddly, but, you know, also then, you know, there's a downside to the dog, you know, the fact that he'll eat all your furniture and get you out of house and home and crap on the rug when you're not there. And so in those situations, you need to talk about it and say, well, maybe it's not the best thing for us together right now.
Now again, we're talking about the owner in terms of how responsive this dog is to the furniture. Now if you have a bad owner and the owner doesn't know how to train this dog, of course he's going to chew on the furniture. It's the communication between you and your dog. Now, for your situation, for instance, I understand your dog at home is eating all kinds of furniture. You know, I think we've said it before, your pet is a direct reflection of the owner.
Yeah, but, you know, pets are pets and dogs are dogs, and sometimes I think that, you know, you really have to make a thoughtful decision on what's going to happen in the future. I mean, you can't just go into this thing just because you got a nice dog. You can't just have a dog. Especially with the expense of a dog. I mean, you know, dogs can just get out of hand. I mean, you can't just buy a dog just because you want a dog.
There's no discussion.
Now, we have been through this up and down before. You know what? I don't even want to talk about it anymore. I'm leaving.
Not that way, pal. So you see, bottom line is, you have to work together in a relationship. Feel free to come over anytime to my house, and the dog will greet you at the door.
Thank you. songs about a ballet style. But they're too infatuated with your wishes, smile, yeah. You've got to survive, to swallow a cry. Oh, oh, I'm not that shape, wanna be in a big company. My tiny jets are to the go-go puppy. You're gonna do the go-go puppy. I love the rain, 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 I love the rain. The rain love me.
This is, hello? Hello?
All right, here's a story. Nobody knows about it. I mean, nobody. Well, people I don't know about it. It happened last winter. I was at a party. I didn't really know anybody, but I was there and we got to talking about bands. And I guess this will kind of show how I felt about all these guys. There's a guy there named Rich. I just met him that night. And we started talking about different bands and crowds, and of course when I was bouncing and stuff. And he said, and so I get to talking about Destiny, which of course is my favorite band. I just brought up the name Destiny at first, but he knew who they were, and he didn't like them. And he started talking about Doug and Rob, and you know, nobody in particular. I knew who he was talking about, and the way they dressed, and the way they acted, and that he didn't like their music, and he started using the word bag, faggots, and things like that. What? They're drinking. Sunday morning, I got a call from the police station. The guy was in the hospital. It's a true story. He was out of work for 6 weeks because something happened when he hit the floor to his hip. It cost me $1,200 cash out of court. I imagine he won't have too much bad to say about Destiny anymore. At least he'll be careful around who he says it. It's kind of an expensive adventure for me, but I think it was worth it. That's probably the best way I can let all them guys know how I felt about them. It was an interesting night. One other person I need to say hello to, Corinne. She's not in the band, but she's just as important. Me and Bill and Corinne had a lot of great times. I think we had a lot of influence on each other. And they were great people. And to finish, need to say hi to Larry and Eric. Out in California, I hope you guys are saving some of the girls for some of the other guys out there. Later.
Okay. Here we are at Ed's video station. We're gonna check it out now. If it weren't for Ed, we wouldn't be able to do this video, so let's just go on inside and check out Ed's store. Oh, here you guys. And here he is, the owner of the video station,
Hello, Ed. Just wanted to say thank you so much for allowing us to do this video. And how's business today, Ed?
Business is just very hectic today, yes.
Any new exciting movies we have today? Oh, and here's Ed's whole store. Check out all the selections. As a matter of fact, I think he has a special on this right here today. This is Crocodile Dundee. Hey, Ed? Maybe not. I don't know. In any case, Ed, is there anything you'd like to tell our viewers at home now? Any special comments you might have for this special, tremendous video we're making?
Yes. The only reason I'm on here is because I let them use my camera. I'm not a friend. They don't know me.
Ed, truthfully, tell us.
Truthfully.
I want to know. This is a very candid question, and since this is not rehearsed, Ed, I want to know, Ed, out of all the videos you have at your house.
At my house, okay.
What percentage of videos, what's the largest percentage of videos you do have at your place right now? Ed, go ahead, tell our viewers back home.
Roughly 99% adult product. Yes, I'm a pervert. So is my roommate Rob, who is also in this thing, I believe.
Well, there you have it from Ed's mouth himself. And Ed, any closing comments before we sign off?
I guess I don't
know. So long from Ed's video station. Hi, out there in TV world. This is Santa Bill. I just wanted to say, at the end of 1987, Merry Christmas.
Our music's calling from our hearts and from our hands. Storm is coming and there's lightning everywhere. Destiny, you're my destiny.